thank you very much, Wolfgang. Today we'll start by saying a couple of things about what am I going to present. Maybe some time ago, I think it was almost 2 years ago, I was working on an article on the topics focusing on human animal. And this was for a conference. And I was looking at this kind of strange philosophical operator, how it worked in different contexts, in different with different philosophers. And I also was looking at the way how what Lacan is doing in psychoanalysis could introduce a kind of a shift into or some kind of a new perspective on this particular wording of the human animal, even perhaps show how it is problematically used or put a problematical concept. But as I was working on this, I got interrupted. I never got to finish this paper because I had to go to a hospital for surgery. Nothing dramatic, as you can see, I survived, but I never finished the paper, and I never went to this conference, and it just remained somewhere. I don't know, I kind of forgot about it, or had suppressed it. And then when I was very recently rereading some Nietzsche for this seminar, particularly gay science, I came across a couple of, more than a couple, a few passages in his book that clicked immediately for me with what I was doing at that time. So actually and then I got an idea how to perhaps go about it and not only include Nietzsche, but I think it was really a way of giving some depth of the field to what I was doing. So what I will present today here is a kind of display of Nietzsche and Lacan around this question, some question of the human animal, and I will simply sketch out the possible argument that I can now see how it would go. So it is a sketch, it's not a completely polished article, but I think it will be clear enough what the argument is. And to some extent it is a kind of unashamedly metaphysical argument in some parts, but I will risk it anyway. And I will try not to be too long, an hour, less than an hour perhaps. So, we could say that roughly speaking, there are two predominant ideas of what human animality refers to. In the first one, the animal of the human animal is cast as the figure of an untamed excess. So this is, of course, this idea is rooted above all in the Christian specific aspect of the Christian imaginary, which at the same time invented kind of autonomy of the excess and casted it as sin, kind of outsourcing it, so to say, to the other in us, the animal. So not that it has much to do with how animals behave, but to behave like an animal can refer here to any kind of human weaknesses, understood as incapacity to control, tame, or suppress some kind of excess or discrepancy. So this is also the image of transgression and above all of kind of excessive enjoyment. Now somehow directly opposed to this figure of an untamed excess is the figure of something lacking any real excess. And I would say that this is actually a predominantly modern figure of the human animal, namely the figure of a kind of organic or else symbolic system closed upon itself, entirely lawful, so to say, reducible to nature in some sense, unable to do something more than be an extension of natural causality, not being ridden by some kind of excessive restlessness, awakened by, I don't know, like being towards death in Heidegger, or jouissance in Lacan, or capacity of truth based on this excès errant in Badiou. So we have this kind of a opposite, almost, figure of the human animal. And perhaps the first example of this modern tradition that comes to mind, in a specific way, of course, is Kant. Namely, if you think of what he calls in his practical philosophy, critic of practical reason, what he calls pathological or non-ethical actions, could simply be defined as actions of the human end. They in no way imply a spectacular or excessive or bestial crimes. Their basic crime is that they do nothing but conform to the law of natural causality, that is, of the human animal, precisely. For example, if I do something out of fear, including fear of God, then for Kant I didn't act ethically. It was I acted as a human animal, so to say, and not as ethical subject. So it is not enough that we conform to the moral law, that we do as it tells us, or we have to figure it out at the same time what it is telling us. But what is needed is that additional excessive only because of the law, which alone indicates for Kant that something else than natural causality, including of course psychological causality, could indeed be at work perhaps at that moment. So the properly human, the human of the is on the side of the axis here, including the excessiveness of the moral law itself, or perhaps starting with the excessiveness of the moral law itself. And of course, it's probably not surprising that Nietzsche suggests yet another perspective, which to some extent, at least, I think, comes close to what Freud and Lacan seem to be suggesting as well. Namely, that perhaps the problem with the human animal, or the term human animal, is that it is not fully what it is supposed to be. That the problem is, or the singularity with humans, the problem is that we should actually shift this question one step back, and the singularity with humans is not that they are half animals, not that they are, sorry, half animals and half something else, but that they are half animals full stop. That is to say, even the half that is supposed to be animal is not fully or properly animal. And the other moral, let's say, half is a disguise, a clothing of this lack, of this leg, sorry, for this failure to be actually fully animal. And I will read you a really interesting passage from Gay Science, where Nietzsche says this. He says, "A naked human being is generally a shameful sight. Suppose that, owing to some magician's malice, the most cheerful company at table suddenly saw itself disrobed and undressed. I believe that their cheerfulness would vanish and that the strongest appetite would be discouraged. It seems that we Europeans simply cannot dispense with that masquerade which one calls clothes. Now we consider," this is still the quote, "now consider the way moral man is dressed up, how he is veiled behind moral formulas and concepts of decency, the way our actions are benevolently concealed by the concepts of duty, virtue, sense of community, honorableness, self-denial. Should the reason for all this not be equally good? I'm not suggesting," this is the final point that he's making, "I'm not suggesting that all this is meant to mask human malice and villainy, the wild animal in us. My idea is, on the contrary, that it is precisely as tame animals that we are a shameful sight and in need of moral disguise. The European disguises himself with morality because he has become sick, crippled animal. For he is almost an abortion, scarce half made up, it was halbes, weak, awkward." End of quote. So it's really an amazing passage, I would say. Okay, Nietzsche speaks of a man becoming such, and of becoming such in a certain geographical location, which is Europe, which of course seems to suggest that somewhere, not here, sometime, not now, there exists a real, full-blown, so to say, animal or human animal. But for the time being, I will not go into this, I think, rather problematic assumption, but simply retain this powerful image of a man or human being as it was harmless, as an animal aborted, so to say, before finished. This is not the image of a man as half animal and half something else, but of a man or human being as a failed animal, basically. As a being the animal part of which is missing something. And humanity appearing, is properly human, whatever I think, appearing or morality appearing as the dress or disguise to cover up this void, this lack, this missing part. And I think the image is interesting for the following reason, because it does not suggest simply a kind of, let's say, vulgar evolutionist notion of that what is properly human as a prosthesis or some complementing the animal's deficiency or weaknesses, making up to it, for it, so to say, like, I don't know, an artificial leg replacing our organic leg appearing at its place, for instance. Or morality as something that helps us survive as crippled animals by other tricks, by deploying other tricks. I don't think this is exactly what is at stake here, although there are points where Nietzsche suggests something of this kind. So the image suggests something different. Dressing up of the missing part, inventing, producing humanity on and around this void without eliminating or filling it out as an artificial organ would, for example. So a crippled animal is dressed up, there is no direct continuity between it and the dress, but this irreducible gap. And now this dress itself becomes the exclusive site of further development or invention of humanity, of what is human. Now in this respect, I think that what the Lacanian psychoanalysis brings to this debate of human animal shares something with this Nietzschean suggestion. Namely, precisely, that there is no human animal, so to say, understood as a kind of fully operative, self-sustained animal entity in man. We could also say there is no zero level of humanity, like, to which this operator would refer, which, if left to itself, would function, for example, on a kind of autopilot function of survival or self-preservation, from which then human being would eventually diverge towards higher and properly human aspirations and accomplishments. Human animal is a half-finished animal, that is to say, an animal that doesn't work or function properly as it is supposed to. Now, to give you a very rough idea how this works, one paragraph in psychoanalysis, of course, it works already on the basic level of the theory of the drives as it was developed by Freud. And the theory of the drives is precisely a conceptualization of deviations at work already at this supposed zero level of organic functions, needs and their satisfaction. So the concept of the drive and of its object is not simply a concept of the deviation from a natural need, but something that actually casts a new and surprising light on the nature of human need as such. And very briefly put, in human beings, all satisfaction of a need allows, in principle, for another satisfaction to occur, to take place, which can then become an independent and self-perpetuating object, reproducing itself, pursuing its own interests, and so on. So there is no natural need that would be absolutely pure, in principle, or a priori devoid of this surplus element, which splits it from within. Drive can neither be completely separated from the biological, organic needs and functions, since it originates with them, within their realm, according to Freud, nor can it be simply reduced to them. There is something that happens there. And of course, this independent life of the drives following their own autonomous logic, which then combines with different things, objects, ideas, and so on, this kind of satisfaction beyond need or pleasure beyond pleasure is, of course, what Lacan refers to as jouissance, this enjoyment in the strong sense of the word, which is not enjoying oneself, having good time in one's pleasure, but it's precisely refers to this kind of paradoxical pleasure or satisfaction that occurs when the pleasure stops, when the normal pleasure stops. Nevertheless, there is this thing that appears unexpectedly and often unworthily. And it is in the latter that Lacan most often situates precisely the difference between animal and human. He says, for example, this is one sentence that says it all, if animal eats regularly, it is clearly because he doesn't know the enjoyment of hunger. This kind of recapitulates the argument that I was making. And this is also the point here, Lacan, I think, is very much into philosophy when he says something like this. I think it is a statement that he makes in relationship to Heidegger, actually, and to his famous Sein zum Tode, being towards that, kind of turning it, twisting in it his own direction, suggesting something slightly different. Namely, if in Heidegger you have this being towards that as precisely the operator, which is not simply something that closes us upon our finitude, but as it is clear from his reading of Kant and Kant's critical break, it is precisely this finitude, this reference to that, that opens up the specifically human dimension of immortality, if you want, or being something else, not reducible to this immediate absorption into the cycle of life and death. So it is this specifically human mode of, let's say, immortality or whatever surplus, human surplus, is precisely made of, possible or based on the specific mode of human finitude. So in respect to this, in relationship to this, I think that the shift that Lacan, the proposition that Lacan introduces in this respect, could be formulated as follows. Namely, that this structural place occupied in Heidegger by death as the very mode of human finitude that grants the specifically human immortality or human exception, if you want, becomes with Lacan jouissance, as related to joy. And this also produces a certain shift in relationship to death itself. Namely, the point Lacan is making here is very precise. It is not simply our attitude towards the possibility of dying that opens up the space of the specifically human dimension, say the possibility of actions which are not reducible to simple causality of the positive order of being, or to this or that calculation of pleasures. On the contrary, now what he suggests is that our being, it is our being situated within an unsought portion of jouissance, which makes different attitudes towards death possible in the first place. Or in other words, death as such in itself does not yet involve the possibility of a dramatic relationship to itself. The latter only occurs when jouissance intervenes. And I will read you a brief quote from Lacan. He says, the dialogue of life and death becomes dramatic only from that moment on when enjoyment, jouissance, intervenes in the equilibrium of life and death. The vital point, the point where a speaking being emerges, is this disturbed, derangé relationship to one's own body, which is called jouissance. So, you see, Lacan's point here could be summed up as follows. Relationship between life and death is or could be in its sense trivial. If it weren't interrupted or complicated from within, something, and on a most basic level, if we sense enjoyment is as disturbed relationship to one's own body, refers to the fact that enjoyment, by way of contaminating, flavoring with enjoyment, the satisfaction of all basic needs of the body, as well as non-satisfaction, possible non-satisfaction of these needs, introduces in the supposed immediacy of living, of satisfying our needs, a crucial gap, a kind of décalage, on account of which things can take a different course than what is supposed to be normal or natural. Again, if animal eats regularly, it is clearly because it doesn't know the enjoyment of hunger. So you see, it is in response that kind of breaks up the supposed circle of animal life and wakes us up to the metaphysics, let me say. So the point is not simply that with human beings, enjoyment can be stronger than the natural need and the pursuit of self-preservation can prevail. The point is rather that it fundamentally modifies the very nature of the natural need. We are no longer dealing with the image of a basis zero level and a deviation from it. Deviations and their signifying support, of course, are human nature. The human body is, we could say, already a grammatical body. And of course, in this perspective, Jouissance is far from being a finitude or closure, irrevocably locking us within the register of human animal, as it is sometimes read. And this is even Badiou, who is definitely the best reader of psychoanalysis and has most interesting things to say about it, has this reading of Jouissance as a kind of, he speaks about the carnal exposition to enjoyment, suffering, and death. Kind of leaving it really on the side, so to say, of the, what he calls the human animal. So it is not death for Lacan, rather it is something that disturbs this animal, wakes it up to a different reality, wakes it up to metaphysics, precisely, makes it do all kinds of strange human or unhuman things. And here is another, I think, quite telling passage from Lacan that states precisely this. He says, what in fact does it mean to be asleep? It means to suspend what is there in my tetragon, the semblance, the truth, the enjoyment, and the surplus enjoyment. This is what the sleep is made for. Anyone who has ever seen an animal sleeping can see that. What is at stake is to suspend the ambiguity at work in the relationship of the body to itself, namely the enjoyment, the joy. When we are asleep, the body wraps itself up, rolls into a ball. To sleep is not to be disturbed, and enjoyment is disturbing. As a matter of course, one is disturbed, but when one is asleep, one can hope not to be disturbed. This is why, starting from here, everything else disappears. There is no longer a question of semblance, nor of truth, nor of surplus enjoyment. Since all this is related, it is the same thing. Yet, as Freud tells us, the signifier keeps working during our sleep as well. End of quote. And of course, here starts the question of dreams and of that enjoyment, the working of the signifier goes on during we are asleep, kind of smuggles into our sleep, to the dream, and which disturbs us, lying there rolled up into a ball and can wake us from within. And of course, I think you probably already see how the edge at stake here is the very rub on which Hamlet's famous dialogue is based upon. You know, this, I mean, read this passage, which is precisely kind of Lacan avant la lettre, he says, to die, to sleep, no more, and by sleep to say we end the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heard. It's a consummation devotedly to be wished, to die, to sleep, perchance to dream, ay, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come, when we have shuffled off this mortal coil, must give us pause. There is the respect that makes calamity of so long life. You see, it is the same logic. What constitutes the problem and makes us twitch, so to say, is not simply the thought of death, but the thought of that which, in the same way it haunts us in the sleep of life, might haunt us in the sleep of our death. It is precisely in this sense, I think, that that drive which conceptualizes this dimension in Lacan is not something that aims at the depth and wants to return simply to the inanimate or something like this. It is rather a strange deviation of the dead, inanimate, from the dead. You know, this, there is something that happens within the dead, deadness itself, which is probably what makes the term undead so appropriate when speaking of the notion of the drive. And actually we find an intriguingly similar idea in Nietzsche. He says, I quote again from Gay Science, let us guard against saying that the dead is the opposite of life. The living is merely a type of what is dead, and a very rare type. Of quote. So, again, this idea that life is not exactly the opposite of death, but more something like its inherent byproduct or deviation or spin. At least this life in this emphatic sense of the word. However, if we return to Lacan, it seems to me that this position which thinks and takes Ruissance and its constitutive deviation as the point of the human exception still contributes to constructing or maintaining the image of the animal, capital A, as the other of man. And it seems that although Lacan dismisses the existence of some this kind of homeostatic primary principle governing human beings, he is nevertheless ready to preserve it or something like it for the rest of the nature, for the animal, who doesn't have these kind of problems, and from which human beings distinguish. And of course the image of the animal that we get in this way seems to be that of a circular complementariness of needs and their satisfaction. Whereas the non-existence of such principle is the prerogative of humans, is what constitutes the human exception. So man is a deviation from the animal, man is half animal, deviation kind of less than nothing, less than animal, half animal. Animal interrupted in the process of being created or becoming, I really like this image. But there is also supposedly a true non-curtailed animal somewhere, conceived as an unproblematic circuit of needs and their satisfaction, from which man deviates. And we have seen at the beginning that there is at least implicitly a similar suggestion also in Nietzsche when he introduces this. These figures. So that of a possibly full, unaborted animal. I think I have the impression that this is a problem conceptually. For it seems, and I'm not denying, I'm not trying to say that there is simply no difference, but I think one needs to conceptualize it in another way. I think this can be a problem conceptually, for it seems to me that with the positing of the drive simply as that kind of what constitutes human exception, we lose some, I think, essential in the concept of the drive, some essential ambiguity which precisely cannot be reduced neither to simply human nor simply animal. And you know that there is this ambiguity with the translation of the Freudian trip, which is his term for the drive, which has been first translated in English and in French by instinct, and only later replaced by this pulsion in French and drive in English. So that it's obvious that there is a problem there. So there is no doubt that what Freud had discovered and named trieb is not instinct in the sense in which we speak of animal instincts as this kind of inborn survivalist autopilot of self-preservation, and it is important to point this difference out. But on the other hand, I think we also risk to miss the point if we simply say that the drive is something completely different, which has nothing whatsoever to do with nature, the animals, or it's completely like human culture or whatever. And if we thus make it the psychoanalytic carrier of the human exception. For this, I think, would mean to go a bit too far and to jump over the most difficult and crucial point which we have to think, and which is precisely, as I said earlier, that the tribe, or if you know, jouissance, is precisely neither, or particularly trip, is precisely neither the one nor the other, neither the simply the animal nor the human. It is, to some extent, a third point, which kind of interrelates them, but it is the operator of the unhuman sense, not it's a very similar concept. So, to recapitulate a little bit, we could say that the topology of the drive can in fact be understood in two ways. It could be understood as positing that with humanity the deviation from organic need piloting the animal is original, and that it is this deviation as original that constitutes human difference exception. So this would be the classical reading strongly supported by what Lacan is saying. Yet there is another possible reading, I think, which pushes further and radicalizes Lacan's position with the help of his own concept. And this other reading suggests not that when we are dealing with humans the deviation is original, but rather that it is as such original, synonymous perhaps with what Žižek called this incomplete ontological constitution of reality. We could say reality as by definition etwas halbes. And in this perspective, human being is not an exception to nature or to the animal. It is something that we could say gets deployed from the point of its, that is of the nature of the animal, inherent impossibility, its inherent difficulty. So that at stake here is not that human being is distinguished by declination from the natural norm of homogeneity of the need and the satisfaction, and that differently from the animal he knows enjoyment. Humanity is not the exception, constituting, let's say, the kind of a whole of the rest of the nature, but the way we could say in which the nature is only through the inclusion of its own impossible or its own exception. And by further deploying it, further declining it even, as we will see. In this perspective, enjoyment is not a distinctive feature. Simply, it is, but not in the sense of that it starts only there, the separation of man. It is not a distinctive feature of man as the other of the animal, but actually the concrete form of the fact, I would say, that the animal does not exist. And not surprisingly, and perhaps hopefully this will come clearer again through Nietzsche, we find a very similar idea in Nietzsche as well. Maybe the idea, and this of course is a kind of speculative metaphysical idea, that ours is already a deviation from deviation. And that what we call nature is itself a kind of aborted, half-made nature. If measured against the image of a round, neatly functioning system or order in which everything has its place or serves its purpose. Again, there is a stunning paragraph 109 of the Gay Science where he suggests many things that strongly resonate, I mean that are related to this, but also strongly resonate with and against contemporary debates of realism as well, and of these new materialisms and the limits of anthropomorphism. And I will now read you a couple of passages from this paragraph. Nietzsche says, the astral order in which we live is an exception. This order and the relative duration that depends on it have again made possible an exception of exceptions. The formation of the organic. The total character of the world, however, in its all eternity is in its all eternity chaos. In the sense not of lack of necessity, but lack of order, arrangement, form, beauty, wisdom, and whatever other names there are for our aesthetic anthropomorphisms. Let us beware of attributing to the universe heartlessness and unreason or their opposites. Nor does it have any instinct for self-preservation or any other instinct. Let us beware of saying that there are laws in nature. There are only necessities. Once you know there are no purposes, you also know that there is no accident, zufall. For it is only beside a world of purposes that the word accident has meaning. There are no eternally enduring substances. Matter is as much an error as the god of the Eleatics. When will all these shadows of God cease to darken our minds? When will we complete our deification of nature? When we begin to naturalize humanity in terms of a pure, newly discovered, newly redeemed nature. And so you see, this is a very Nietzschean and quite dense thing, but I think this newly discovered nature, isn't it precisely this kind of nature that is not around at all, ruled by instincts and serving certain purposes, to which human being would constitute an exception? If anything, nature is an exception, and human being is a kind of further declination of this exception. And in this sense, naturalized again. And from there it follows, and this is a kind of a, yeah, a very wild hypothesis, but from there it follows that you could say that natural norm, say the unproblematic instinct, homogeneity of the need and its satisfaction, or broadly biological, chemical, physical laws, all this is actually secondary in respect to the incomplete ontological constitution of nature, in respect to nature as it was had. Yet this does not mean, and here I'm proposing a different perspective from what Nietzsche is saying, I think this does not mean that this norm or these laws do not really exist and that they are just a way how we domesticate and think what is in itself a completely chaotic, incomplete nature. I think one should make another step which actually radicalizes this without getting rid of the concept of the law. Namely, the incomplete ontological constitution is not synonymous with chaos. The point is elsewhere. The nature is lawful, we could say, in the scientific sense, yet this lawfulness is precisely nothing else but the very structuration and solution of its own inner antagonism, or chaos, of its being it was harmless. We could even say it is the very form of this chaos. And in this sense, I think the position between contingency and necessity is no longer supernatural here. There is something that actually, this is precisely the way how they work together, as they do in Hegel, for instance. But in this sense, the laws of nature, we could exist precisely through and because of the inexistence of nature with capital N, in this sense of this image of nature that knows what it is doing. And of course, I think it's no coincidence that the Galilean physics starts off precisely by this kind of claim. Nature, in this sense, does not exist. And the lawfulness of nature is therefore not the other of nature as inconsistent or chaotic, but it is one with precisely non-existence of such nature. However, and this is crucial, this is, I'm coming to the final part of my paper, the move here is not simply that of relativizing and or simply broadening the exception by saying that, okay, the logic of the drive exists already at the level of the animal or even of life as such or even somewhere else or of being as such. What is at stake is not to posit something like the drive as the origin of the world, so to say, be it human or broader. Rather, I see it as it is to circumscribe or isolate it as a point of view for which appear the differences between man, animals, stone, whatever. A point of view that belongs to no human or animal nor stone. A point of view of the object in the strict Lacanian sense of the term. And I think this is perhaps the as objective as we can get precisely by clinging on to this dimension of objectivity. And now to give you an example, I hope it's not it's the right one, but it's definitely a very telling one, and probably you know it. I think that one way of illustrating this impossible point of view is via the example, you know, that Derrida gives in his famous paper, The Animal That Therefore I Am, where he evokes the cat watching his naked body. You know, there is this famous scene when after waking he goes naked to the bathroom where his cat follows him, and then this awkward moment occurs because he's standing in front of the cat which is looking at his naked body, and unable to endure this situation, he puts a towel around his waist and chases the cat outside, and then takes the shower. Because where is the object driving this scene? I think it's neither in the Derrida nor in the cat. It is precisely the object that kind of materializes in this scene, or perhaps even more precisely, the object that materializes this thing, scene, like constituting it, making it possible, bringing it about in this world. And I'll come a little bit to that at the end. Just one more brief point. Maybe what I find, and it is related to this question of a point of view, which is not always the same, and I think this is really a non-phantasmatic point of view. But what I find, for instance, problematic in many recent attempts at reviving this kind of non-anthropomorphic perspective on the world or on being as such, is that these attempts very easily fall victim to what is actually a most subjective, most phantasmatic point of view. Namely, at some level, most of them seem to involve and mobilize the following fantasy. Imagine the world without me. Or imagine the world without us. How would the world look without me? And actually, we find this idea in Nietzsche as well. Here he's not at his best, although it's again a very beautiful passage. When he writes, for example, once upon a time, in some out of the way corner of that universe, which is dispersed into numberless twinkling solar systems, there was a star upon which clever beasts invented knowing. This was the most arrogant and mendacious minute of world history, but nevertheless it was only a minute. After nature had drawn a few breaths, the star cooled and congealed, and the clever beast had to die. One might invent such a fable, he says, and yet he still would not have adequately illustrated how miserable, how shadowy, transient, how aimless and arbitrary the human intellect looks within nature. There were eternities during which it did not exist, and when it is all over with the human intellect, nothing will have happened. What I feel about this quote is the following ambiguity. While it is absolutely true that the universe does not give a damn about what happens to us, there is, I think, also something absolutely wrong in this way of putting it. Why should it give a damn after all? I mean, the point of view from which we see the nature or universe not giving a damn about us is, I claim, the most subjective point of view imaginable. It is, I think, what is the fantasy par excellence as defined by psychoanalysis, the fantasy at its purest. And it certainly is, I think, miles away from any allegable break with anthropocentrism. So instead of this gesture of trying to remove ourselves from the picture and see what happens there when we are away. We should rather say, I think, not exactly imagine the world with me, but something like, here is the world with me. Which is, I think, not all that easy to actually say this for real. And perhaps if I just pursue the same example, perhaps this is exactly the experience that Derrida makes when the cat is looking at his naked body. This is the world with me in it. Okay, this is all. Thank you very much.